Welcome back, students. This is the third lecture in the chapter of magnetism. In the previous lecture, we had studied about three different types of magnetic materials, that is diamagnetic, paramagnetic and ferromagnetic. Now, in the ferromagnetic materials, they have a special property, okay, what is called as a domain structure. So this domain structure is exhibited only by ferromagnetic materials. So what is the meaning of domains? So domains are basically small regions in a ferromagnetic material in which all the magnetic dipoles, all the atomic dipoles are oriented in one direction. So for example, we have a ferromagnetic material over here. In this material, so this is the ferromagnetic material. Now this part over here is one domain. Okay, this is one domain of the ferromagnetic material. Now what you see in that, so this is one domain, in that all the magnetic dipoles are oriented in this direction. So if you sum them all up, the net magnetization is therefore in this direction. So this is in this region, this domain. If you consider another region there, another domain, so let us say this domain here, all the magnetic dipoles inside it are oriented in this direction, so that the net magnetization is therefore in this direction. So like that, the entire ferromagnetic material can be imagined to be made up of small regions in which all the magnetic dipoles in that particular one region are all pointing in the same direction. So this is called one domain. Different domains have different direction orientations, and that's why in the absence of a magnetic field, the net magnetization is zero, because all the domains are randomly oriented. So if you sum the magnetic moments of all these different domains, the net magnetization comes to zero. So that is what we mentioned over here. So in the absence of magnetic field, the net magnetization of the material is zero. But what happens when we apply a magnetic field? We know that a ferromagnetic material gets magnetized when we apply a magnetic field. So with respect to these domains, what happens inside a ferromagnetic material when we apply a magnetic field? So there are two types of processes which take place inside the material when you apply a magnetic field. So what happens is, so this first figure A here, what it shows you is the situation in the absence of a magnetic field. So the magnetic domains, individual magnetic domains, are randomly oriented, one this way, one down, might be one this side and one upwards like this. So that if you see the sum of all these things, the net will come to zero. So net magnetization in the absence of magnetic field is zero. Next, now what we are doing is, we are applying a magnetic field in this upward direction. Magnetic field H, we are applying the material in the upward direction. So two processes take place over here, which I mentioned over here. One is called domain growth, and the second one is called as domain rotation. Domain growth occurs when the field applied is less. As you keep on increasing the field, then the process of domain rotation starts occurring. So initially, for low field values, domain growth process is more dominant, whereas for higher field values, the domain rotation process is more dominant. So what are these two processes? What happens in domain growth, which is shown over here in figure B? Since you have applied a field in this upward direction, whichever domain was in that direction of the field, the size of that domain increases. You can see this domain here, this domain, it's in the absence of magnetic field, it had a magnetic dipole, magnetic orientation in the upward direction. So the applied, since the applied magnetic field is also in the upward direction, this domain here, this domain, it starts increasing in size at the expense of the other domains which are not in the direction of the applied field. So what has happened is, this domain has increased, you see. It has become bigger in size. And what has happened to the other domains? They have reduced in size. So the domain which is in the direction of the applied magnetic field increases, and the other domains decrease. So this process is called as domain growth. And this happens at low magnetic fields. But then as you keep on increasing and increasing the magnetic field, there's a second process which also starts occurring, that is called as domain rotation. So now what has happened is, what has happened over here, this domain, initially it was in this direction. But now as we kept on increasing the field, it also is trying to rotate upwards, because the applied magnetic field is upwards. This domain was pointing towards the right, but now, as since the field has become very large, high magnetic field is applied, this domain also starts rotating in the upward direction. So you can see here, it is slightly rotated in the upward direction. This domain over here, it was pointing towards the left, it also has slightly rotated in the upward direction, as you can see over here. This domain also, which was completely down, it was completely in the opposite direction compared to the applied field. It also has slightly rotated and tried to come in the upward direction. So it was also slightly moved towards the upward direction. So all the domains which are not in the direction of applied magnetic field, they rotate, the domains rotate, the magnetic moments in them rotate, so that they are slightly pointing towards the direction of the applied magnetic field. So this process, which is shown in figure C here, wherein the domains rotate, is called as domain rotation. The domain sizes remain the same, the full domain itself rotates in this process. So in the first process, the domain size increases in the favorable orientation, whereas in the second process, the entire domains rotate in the direction of the applied magnetic field. So this is how the material gets magnetized. So now if you see the net, in this figure A, the net magnetization was zero. In figure B now, the net magnetization will be upwards. Why? Because the major part of the material now has a domain which is in the direction of the applied field. So the magnetization is in the upward direction. So the material gets magnetized. Figure C also, the net magnetization, if you see the resultant of all that thing, it is in the upward direction. So this is how the material gets magnetized when you apply a magnetic field, and this is with respect to the domain theory. Now what happens is, when your external field is removed, when you remove the magnetic field, these domains slightly may go back to the original direction, they may also slightly reduce in size, but overall, whichever domains had increased in size, they almost remain the same size, they do not come back to the original size and original directions. So what happens is that the material still, even after removal of the magnetic field, it retains some of its magnetization. So and the material becomes a permanent magnet. Why? Because the domains do not come back to their original size or their original directions even after the magnetic field is removed. So this is how we explain magnetization of a ferromagnetic material using the domain theory. The next important part in this chapter is also related to a ferromagnetic material, is what is called as a hysteresis loop. So hysteresis and hysteresis loop is also properties only exhibited by ferromagnetic materials, not by paramagnetic and diamagnetic. So what is this hysteresis loop? What is observed is that in a ferromagnetic material, the magnetization M lags behind the applied field H. So magnetization M lags behind the applied magnetic field H. So what it means by that is that as you change the magnetic field, the magnetization also does not change in the same way as you change the applied field. So for example, if you decrease the magnetic field by, let us say, 4 units, the magnetization also will not increase by the same amount, 4 units. It may decrease by little, but not in the same extent as the decrease in the applied field. So you may change the field, but the magnetization will not follow the exact change in the applied field. So in other words, you can say that the magnetization is lagging behind the applied field. So you may change the field to a large extent, but the magnetization will not change to that same extent. So it is lagging behind the applied field. So because of this, we get what is called as hysteresis. So hysteresis is basically difference. You are changing this, but the other thing is not changing to the same extent. There is some difference between the two things. So there is hysteresis between the magnetization and the applied magnetic field. So what is the hysteresis loop then? If we subject a ferromagnetic material to one complete cycle of magnetization, so what is the meaning of one complete cycle? Let's say you start from zero. You increase it, make the field maximum, then decrease the field, come back to zero, then you apply the field in the negative direction, increase it in the negative direction, and then come back to zero. So this is one cycle, it's like AC signal. So one full, when you run the magnetic field into the magnetic material over one complete cycle, we get such type of a loop formation, which is shown in the figure here. and this is called as a hysteresis loop. So basically, hysteresis loop arises because the MH is lagging behind, because of the magnetization lagging behind the applied field, we get a hysteresis loop like this. We'll see how we get exactly this hysteresis loop. We'll trace it right from the center point O, and we'll see how we get a hysteresis loop. So to begin with, we start with a unmagnetized sample, unmagnetized ferromagnetic sample. So this is point O. So it's unmagnetized, magnetization is zero. It doesn't have any magnetic, the net magnetization inside it is zero. And we start with a zero magnetic field also. So it's 0, 0. Magnetization also is zero. And by the way, this B, we can also replace it with M, okay? So because you remember formula for B and M, magnetic induction B and magnetization M, they are related as B is equal to H plus M. So as you increase magnetization, automatically magnetic induction B also increases. Okay, so as M increases, B also increases. So we can always interchange between B and M. So, so magnetization or magnetic induction is along the y-axis, and applied magnetic field H is along the x-axis. So now, to start with, we start with the unmagnetized sample, and we start with zero magnetic field. So it is 0, 0 at point O. Then, as we increase the magnetic field, the magnetization also increases. You can see in this graph, there is an increase. As in the magnetic field, the magnetization also is increasing. And then it starts to become constant, it starts to become saturated value. Okay, towards point A, if you keep on increasing it, it will attain a constant value that is called as saturation. So that occurs at point A, let us say. So beyond point A, if you increase it, the magnetization will remain the same value as indicated at point A. So what has happened initially? As you increase the magnetic field from point O, the magnetization also has increased, and then it has attained the constant value. Next, from O to A, as you increase the magnetic field, the magnetization also is increasing. It reaches saturation at point A. Then, as we now decrease the magnetic field, as we are coming back towards zero, so we are decreasing magnetic field, you see the magnetization does not trace the same path it had traced from O to A. It rather goes from along another path, AC. So what we see there is that whatever path initially the magnetization had taken, while reducing the magnetic field, it doesn't come back on the same path. It follows a different path. And what is important to note is that at point C, the value of magnetic field H is zero because it's at along the y-axis. So H value is zero. But the magnetization M is still not zero, so this much value is still remaining. So this value OC is what is still the amount of magnetization remaining in the material, and this OC is called as the retentivity or remanence of the material. So this OC value tells us how much amount of magnetization still remain in the material even after you remove the magnetizing field H. Okay, so that's what we can see over here. The magnetization is lagging behind the applied magnetic field. We have made the magnetic field zero, but the magnetization still not become zero. So magnetization is behind the applied field. So it lags behind the applied magnetic field. Then, as we further decrease the magnetic field, further decrease it in the negative direction, the magnetization from point C, it is decreasing, coming towards point D. At point D, the magnetization becomes zero because you can see it's on the x-axis. X-axis means M value or B value is zero. So at point D, the magnetization becomes zero. So this amount of magnetic field which you require, the amount of magnetic field required to make this value from here to here, the amount of magnetic field required in the reverse direction to make the magnetization in the material zero is called as the coercivity. It's shown over here. So retentivity is the magnetization retain the material even after the magnetic field is made zero. That's retentivity. Whereas coercivity is the magnetic field required to make the magnetization in the material zero. So then, as we continue further, if we further decrease the magnetic field in the negative direction, the magnetization again starts increasing in the negative direction. It again attains a saturation value, negative saturation value at point E. If you continue to decrease the magnetic field further in the negative direction, the magnetization will no longer further increase. It attains a saturation value. Then if we start again increasing the magnetic field towards the positive direction, towards zero, and then in the magnetization follows this curve EF. Again at F, the field has become zero, but the magnetization is still not become zero. So this again is the retentivity. So retentivity is either OC or OF. Both are exactly equal. Okay, it's a symmetrical curve. So OC and OF, both can be called as the retentivity. OC is the retentivity in the positive direction. OF is the retentivity in the negative direction. But in value, they are both the same. Then if you again start increasing the magnetic field towards the positive side, again the magnetization increases from F to G, magnetization decreases, sorry, and at point G it becomes zero again. So this value again OG is also the coercivity. So this value OG is also the coercivity, but in the positive direction. So OD and OG both can be said to be as coercivity. The values are same, but they are in opposite directions. They are, one is positive, one is negative. And then further you increase the magnetic field from G, if you further increase it, it goes along this path, GA. And then it continues. So this cycle, you started from zero, you went, increase the magnetic field towards a large value, then you came back towards zero, then you increase the magnetic field towards the negative direction, then you came back to zero, and then you continue the cycle. So this is like one full cycle, positive, negative, zero to positive to zero, then negative, maximum to again zero. Okay? So this is one full cycle of the applied magnetic field, and the hysteresis loop is traced in this way, or as you vary the magnetic field for one full cycle, positive and negative. And now remember, this curve OA will never be traced again. It is only in the beginning. The trace OA, you will get it only when you start with the unmagnetized sample. Once one full cycle of magnetization is run over the sample, the curve OA will never be traced again. It will always go along AC, D, E, F, G, A, and then over and over again along the same direction. So that's what is the hysteresis loop. Here see. So O, initially to start the unmagnetized sample, you start from O, then from O it goes to A, C, D, E, F, G, A, and then it repeats over and over again along the same thing. A, C, D, E, F, G, A. And this is nothing but the hysteresis loop. So we already defined what is retentivity and coercivity, the two important definitions which you need to know. Now last thing regarding the hysteresis is what is called as hysteresis loss. Now when you run the magnetic field for one full cycle, there is a heat generated in the heat which generated in the ferromagnetic material. So for example, if you touch a transformer or any other motor of a AC motor as well, you will feel the heat in it. Why? Where does heat come from? It's basically the amount of heat loss for the magnetization to increase, come back to zero, increase in the negative direction and then come back to zero. For one running of one hysteresis cycle, the energy which is lost in the material is coming out as heat. So what is the hysteresis loss? Hysteresis loss is nothing but the area under the loop. Whatever is the area under this hysteresis curve, this area gives you the hysteresis loss, the amount of energy lost in one full cycle of the magnetization. So hysteresis loss is equal to area of the BH curve or area of the MH curve. Area of the hysteresis loop gives you the hysteresis loss in one cycle of the AC magnetic field. Now, ferromagnetic materials are classified into two categories: soft magnetic materials and hard magnetic materials. And this classification is done based on the type of hysteresis loop which they generate. When you subject them to an AC magnetic field for one full cycle, the hysteresis loop which they produce, based on that, we classify them either into soft magnetic materials or hard magnetic materials. So what are soft magnetic materials? Those ferromagnetic materials which form a very small hysteresis loop. Okay? So you see the area of the hysteresis loop is very small over here for a soft magnetic material. The coercivity values which you see here and here is also very small. This is the coercivity, or this is also, this is the coercivity. They are very small values. So what does it mean is that these materials, soft magnetic materials, it is very easy to magnetize them, very easy to demagnetize them also. So it do not require a very large magnetic field to demagnetize them. A very small magnetic field is enough to demagnetize them. So that's why they are called as soft. Okay, they can easily be magnetized and demagnetized. So they have a small hysteresis loop. These, they can be easily magnetized and demagnetized. The cohesivity and retentivity are small. As I already mentioned, cohesivity and retentivity of the materials are also very small. So because of that, these materials are mostly used for, we'll come to the application later on, permeability and susceptibility of these materials are high. So mu value and high value of soft magnetic materials are high. Resistivity of these materials is also very high, so therefore the eddy current losses, so current, if the resistance of the material was less, current would have been more and eddy current losses would have been more. But this soft magnetic materials have a high resistivity, hence the eddy currents in it are less, and so the eddy current losses also in it are less. So they will, so these materials, where are they therefore used? They are mostly used to make cores in transformers, in motors, because you remember, if too much of hysteresis loss is there, too much of energy will be wasted in the transformer core, on the core of a electric motor. So soft magnetic materials, which can be easily magnetized and demagnetized, are therefore used in soft iron cores of transformers and magnetic other machines which require a magnetic core inside them. Example of soft magnetic materials are iron, silicon alloy, then nickel iron alloy, nickel, iron, molybdenum and manganese alloy, and all the ferrites. There are certain classes of materials called as ferrites. All these ferrites are soft magnetic materials. So these are the ferrites which are only used in transformer cores, which because they have a very less hysteresis loss in them. The other type of materials are hard magnetic materials. You can see the area of the hysteresis loop over here is large. Okay, so the cohesivity is quite a large value for hard magnetic materials. So it is difficult, so once you magnetize them, it is difficult to demagnetize them. You will require to apply a very large magnetic field in the reverse direction to demagnetize these materials. So they have a large hysteresis loop area. It is difficult to magnetize and demagnetize them. And they have a high value of cohesivity and retentivity. Permeability and susceptibility values are less. So mu value and chi value for hard magnetic materials are small values. Okay, they are small. So where are the examples of hard magnetic materials are carbon steel, tungsten, chromium steel and alnico. It's an alloy of aluminium, nickel and cobalt. It's the most commonly used hard magnetic material, alnico. And applications, they are used wherever you require a permanent magnet. So hard magnetic materials are mostly used to make permanent magnets. So where do we find permanent magnets? We find them in DC motors, you will find them in loudspeakers, then in your compass, okay, the needle, magnetic needle of a compass, north-south pointing compass is actually a permanent magnet there. Then the moving coil, galvanometers, moving coil, voltmeters, ammeters, they have a permanent magnet in them. So any device which requires a permanent magnet, we use hard magnetic materials over there. So these are the types of magnetic materials, soft magnetic materials and hard magnetic materials. Remember, both of them are ferromagnetic in nature. Okay, so ferromagnetic materials are either hard or soft. So with this, we come to an end of this chapter on magnetism. There is another of first part of the magnetism chapter. There is another part of CRO, which I will do in a next class. Rather, CRO is a slightly big topic, but CRO, remember, it comes under in the same chapter of magnetism. So we'll do that in a separate class. But before we end this class, I will do just one example numerical problem in this chapter of magnetism. Okay. So there are very few problems in this. A very small chapter, first of all, on magnetism, and there's basically one or two problems which have come in the question paper based on this chapter. So we have a problem over here: a magnetic material with susceptibility of 0.3 into 10 raised to power minus 5 is subjected to a magnetic field strength of 1000 ampere per meter. Calculate the magnetization of the material and also calculate the magnetic flux density of the field inside the material. So what is given to us over here is magnetic susceptibility, that is chi. So chi is given to us as minus 0.3 into 10 raised to the power minus 5. Remember, chi doesn't have units. It's a dimensionless, unitless quantity. So, no units. What else is given to us is magnetic field strength. So, H is given to us. H is given to us as 1000 ampere per meter. We are required to find what is the magnetization. So, what is M? We need to find this. And also, we need to find magnetic flux density, which is B. So, two things we need to find in this problem. One is the magnetization and one is the magnetic flux density or magnetic induction. So, how to find M? It's very simple to find the value of M. Remember the relation which connects M and magnetization and applied magnetic field. So, magnetization is chi times H. Remember we had said magnetization is directly proportional to the applied magnetic field H. And the proportionality constant between them is chi. So, M is equal to chi times H. So, using this thing, we directly find the value of magnetization. So, this is minus 0.3 into 10 raised to the power minus 5 into 1000. So, this value will come out to be, so this is minus 5 and this is 10 raised to 3. 1000 means 10 raised to 3. So, it will become minus 0.3 into 10 raised to the power minus 2. And what are the units of magnetization? Magnetization will have the same units of applied magnetic field, which is H. H has units of ampere per meter. So magnetization also will have units of ampere per meter. Okay, so this is the first part of the problem. We have calculated the magnetization in the material. Next part is to find the magnetic flux density B. Now what's the formula for B? B is given with the formula mu 0 into H plus M. So now what is mu 0? Mu 0 is the permeability of free space. It has a value 4 pi into 10 raised to the power minus 7 into H value is 1000, it's given to us, whereas M value is minus 0.3 into 10 raised to the power minus 2 . It's negative, so that's why the minus sign comes there. Remember, magnetization is negative. What does it indicate? It is negative. It indicates that it's a diamagnetic material. Okay, so chi value is negative means it's a diamagnetic material. You apply magnetic field in one direction, the substance gets magnetized in the opposite direction. So that's why magnetization is negative, minus 0.3 into 10 raised to the power minus 2. So therefore, the sign over here also is minus. So if we find the answer of this, this will come out to be 1.26 into 10 raised to the power minus 3. What will be the units of this quantity? This is magnetic flux density. It is also called magnetic induction. And units of this, SI units of this are Tesla, which is noted by the symbol capital T. Okay. So these are the two answers which are required. This is the magnetization and this is the flux density, magnetic flux density or magnetic induction. So with this, I'll finish with this lecture and we'll do the remaining part in the next lecture. That's about the CRO. We're studying about the cathode ray oscilloscope in the next